for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J speaks on the family and the state from Acton's annual conference. She also takes questions after the talk. Check out the next podcast for that.
This is the second lecture in the family series. This one is the family and the state. This one's about the family and the state, okay? And there's a subject that I'm not going to mention in my talk, but you can ask about it in the questions if you want to. I'll answer questions on any topic you want when the time comes, okay? So I'm going to start this lecture about the family and the state with this very sensitive little mouse clicker, okay? I'm going to start with a thought experiment, okay? Before I begin, let me point out that my colleague, Jennifer Teamy, is sitting in the back of the room, who has information about the Ruth Institute and also our sign-up sheets for our Ruth Institute newsletter. So if anybody needs that or has not signed up for it that would like to, go ahead. I want to start this talk about the relationship between the family and the state with this thought experiment. We have here a very cute-looking little family here. Looks like a mother and a father and a baby. The sunglasses are the dead giveaway that they're related to each other. I don't know how they did that. I don't know how that birth thing works there, how the sunglasses are genetic. But anyway, we've got the mother, the father, and the baby. And I want to just put this question in your mind. What does society owe to these people? Is there anything that is owed to these three people by the state, by society, or anything or anyone else? And I want to just let that roll around in your mind for a minute. A lot of people of libertarian inclination might say nobody owes anything to anybody, right? The sort of Ayn Rand position is nobody owes anything to anybody. But I want to broaden your mind here in the sense that I'm not asking does anybody owe them any money or resources or support or anything like that, and put a different kind of obligation into your mind. Because I think the state and the whole society actually does owe the three of them something. There's something that is owed to them as a duty in justice. And that is that I believe the whole society has a duty and justice to recognize that these two people are in fact the parents of this child and that no one else is, okay? That the biological mother and father are the parents of this child and nobody else is. So it doesn't matter if you're the former boyfriend, if you're grandma or grandpa. It doesn't matter if you're the babysitter who spends more time with the child. It doesn't matter if you are the next door neighbor who's kind of a busybody and who has a PhD in child development and you think you know better. It doesn't matter. These two people are the parents of the child and no one else is. And I would say to you that that's a duty and justice and that it is intrinsically a public function here, okay? It's something that's intrinsically public. In other words, these two people could make a contract with each other for all sorts of things, and I know a lot of libertarians like to think about contracts all the time. And you know, if we can conceptualize something as a contract, we bow down and worship it three times because we think we've got the answer to everything. You guys aren't laughing. Do you know what I'm talking about? Do you know the sort of thing I'm talking about here, right? I mean, you know, if we think we can make it into a metaphorical contract, we think we've got the answer. But I just want you to think about that for a minute. Mom and Dad can make a contract between the two of them, which might be binding in some way between the two of them about their rights and responsibilities with respect to each other and that child. But there's no contract the two of them can make with each other that will automatically exclude grandma and the next door neighbor, right? The only way grandma and the next door neighbor can be excluded as possible parents is if the state does something to assist them, right? You see what I mean? So there's something here that's intrinsically public. When you say that we're going to identify who the parents are, and by the way, once we've identified that these are the two parents, then if you're going to do something else for this kid, these two people have to be consulted in some way, right? If there's going to be an adoption, they have to give consent. If they've been negligent, the state has to prove that they've been negligent, right? But you start from the default position that these two are the parents of the child, okay? And that, I want to suggest, is an intrinsically social function, intrinsically a public function that cannot really be privatized. So I want to start with that thought in your mind as we begin this talk. topic of the relationship between the family and the state. So I'm going to follow the outline of the presentation pretty closely of what you have there in front of you. And these are the questions we're going to try to answer. We're going to try to answer, how does the family fit in with the overall society? How does it fit into the big picture? We often hear people say the family is the most basic unit of society. I want to spell out a little bit what I mean by that when somebody says that, because we hear it so often it's almost like a cliche, and it doesn't have any meaning if you say it too often without thinking about it. So we want to spell that out a little bit. And then we want to ask the important questions: has the state in fact been undermining the family? And is it possible for the state to be neutral with respect to the family? Because a lot of times we hear arguments that are framed as fairness arguments that have the form of the government shouldn't be privileging one form of family over any other. The government should be neutral with respect to people's family decisions. Anything people want to decide should be perfectly fine, and so on. You often hear these arguments. So we want to, at the end of the talk, spell out whether that's a coherent idea, whether that's something that can actually be operationalized, or whether that's, cover for something else. It's going to take me a while to figure out how to use this gizmo. Let's see. There we go. Okay. Got it right the first time. All right. So I want to begin by talking with you just for a few moments about the family as a social institution. What are social institutions? Why do we need them? Now, if you've been hanging around Acton for a while, I know some of you are first-timers, but some of you have been hanging around for a while, you know that a lot of times we talk about there being three broad sectors within society: the economic sphere, the political sphere, and then the social and cultural sphere. And if you think about what Acton's about, we're really all about that social and cultural sphere, and with religion being one of the big planks of the social-cultural realm. So a lot of what Acton does is related to economics, but not directly related to the government or public policy. They're much more about the culture, okay? And so I'm going to continue to use that three-part division or that three-part understanding and just point out that each of these three sectors has its own role, and it has its own limits, and it has its own proper boundaries. You know, in other words, you shouldn't be invading, the sphere shouldn't be invading each other's space, okay? And those of you who've had the classes on Abraham Kuyper, you know that the sphere sovereignty is a very important idea there, okay? And I'm not going to go into that in too much detail. I just want to flesh out some of what we mean by a social institution. The key idea that I want to get across to you, because obviously this is a very rich topic and a lot could be said about it, but that a social institution is more than a mere collection of individuals. Okay, a social institution is more than a collection of individuals. So in this room, there's a collection of individuals. There's a bunch of us in here listening to my talk. But you could not claim that we form some kind of social institution, because when the talk's over, we're all going to go our separate ways, and that's the end of it, okay? But some things, some institutions of society, are things that where the sum is more, where the whole is more than the sum of the parts, okay? And there are a couple of ways to operationalize that. One is we can talk about there being actual team production, you know, where you're not just hiring people, but that the team is working together in some way that is more than the sum of the parts. There's more coming out of it than just adding up inputs. And also, importantly, that whatever it is that they're doing, whatever it is the group is doing, you can't privatize it easily. In other words, you can't break it down into its constituent elements and give part of it to each member of the social institution. So if you think about something like a symphony orchestra, okay, the symphony orchestra, all of the different players come in with their instruments and they all go out with their instruments, right? But what they do together as the symphony orchestra is something bigger than any one of them can do, okay? So the Chicago Symphony is more than the sum of the parts. That's the point. And also, if you've got a genuine social institution that's more than just a collection of individuals, a social institution can actually have its own legal identity. Okay, so a corporation would be the most obvious example here that would be familiar to a lot of people. A corporation is a legal person, and the corporation can outlive any particular member, any particular person who's participating in the corporation. So there's more there than just the collection of individuals. And think about it for a moment. The corporation is a legal form that allows a group of people to get together and do something, and that group of people doing something has an existence of its own, And it outlives any of those people, and so it can go on. The corporate identity of Coca-Cola or Ford Motor Company or whatever it is can outlive any of those particular individuals. When you go to work for Ford Motor Company, you don't lose your individual identity, but you are part of something that is separate from yourself in some way. Okay? So there's more here than just the sum of the parts. Now, why am I bothering to tell you about this? Because the family, and marriage in particular, is, I think, a classic social institution. Not only is it a social institution, think about it, it's a pre-political social institution. That is, the existence of the family goes back to the Garden of Eden. It has been there since before there was ever any form of government now known to the human race. Right? Now, what is the product of a marriage? Well, the joint product of the marriage, you know, is a kind of teamwork called a baby. Right? Takes one man, one woman, you can make a baby. It doesn't usually take a lot of coaxing. Right? A man and woman could do this spontaneously without any help, without any, you know, particular incentive base usually. You know, they can handle it. They can do this. And it's a genuine team effort in that you can't divide the product. Right? I mean, if you divide the product, what do you have? You have poor kids, you know, going back and forth to houses and back with their backpacks and their sleeping bags, you know, trying to have an existence between two households. It doesn't really work to try to divide the product. Okay? So marriage is a genuine social institution in the sense that it produces something that cannot be produced by just a collection of individuals, right? It's genuine team production, and there would be something truly lost if you tried to break this down into a collection of mere individuals, because both of the parents, remember those people I showed you at the beginning? Both of those parents have some rights and responsibilities with respect to the child. Okay, remember the cute people with their sunglasses. They both have rights and responsibilities with respect to the child. It would be wrong for the man to leave the family and say, it's your problem. It would be wrong for the woman to say, get out of here, it's my baby, not yours, go away. Either of those positions would be wrong. And when I said at the beginning, society has a responsibility, an obligation and justice to recognize those two people as the parents of the child, that's what I'm talking about. That the society would support and sustain them in the event that somebody's shirking, right? And abandoning the family counts as shirking. Right? Wouldn't that count as shirking? So that's what I'm talking about when I say that there are some rights and responsibilities with respect to marriage. Now, some of you may be familiar with Pope Leo XIII and his work called Rerum Novarum. I don't know if you guys are still talking about that in your foundational lectures. I think they used to talk about that in one of the foundational lectures. This is the Rerum Novarum means of new things, and it's one of the first documents of Catholic social teaching. And there's a lot of meat in Rerum Novarum, and if I'm not mistaken, tomorrow Father D'Souza will be talking about Leo XIII's thought. I'm pretty sure that's happening tomorrow. I'm pretty sure we haven't missed it. But in any case, there's a lot of meat in Rerum Novarum. And one of the things he talks about is that the state has no right to take over the social institutions of society. And when he was talking about this, this was in 1891, he was particularly attacking socialism and saying that the state has no right to take over the institution of private property and to take over the institution of the family. And he saw those two things as being linked. Okay, it was his position that there was a natural right of the father of the family to take care of his family, which meant he had to own some property. He had to be able to own some property. The idea that you were going to somehow rescue the working class by abolishing private property, he thought was simply wrong and was not Christian. Okay, and so he condemned it for that reason. Now, there's an alternative view of the family. You might recognize one of these guys over here with a big, well, they both have big, big bushy beards, but you probably recognize this guy as Karl Marx. The other guy is his sidekick over there, Frederick Engels. Okay, they had an alternative view of the family and the place of the family, and basically their position was that they hated it. Okay, they hated the monogamous family as much as they hated private property. And Marx didn't live long enough to write all this out, but Engels wrote this up in a book called The Origin of the Family, Private Property and the State. He wrote that up in 1884. And in that book, he talks about the wife as the proletariat and the husband as the bourgeois. Okay, I'm not even kidding. It's not like it's metaphorical. No, he flat out says it, that the institution of monogamous marriage is an oppressive institution. He flat out says it is an oppressive institution. And so, he has got a whole historical analysis, which I think is wrong, but his whole historical analysis is that there used to be some time of primitive communism, and during that time of primitive communism, there was also a time of group marriage, where people lived together, had sex with one another, and nobody cared who was the parents of any children. Now, when you read this book, through a modern lens, two things will jump out at you. And I wouldn't necessarily recommend that you read this book, but you know, if you're interested in this subject, you probably should be familiar with what they do in here, because it is kind of crazy. But anyway, what's crazy about it, the thing that will jump out at you that's crazy, is that this book is all about creating equality in the relationship between the man and the wife, between the husband and the wife. It's all about gender equality. That's what this book is concerned with. And children are not in the picture. So the unique situations created by the vulnerability of the pregnant woman, the vulnerability of the child, that's an afterthought. That's not even there. Okay? They don't even think about that. They're just worried about what can we do to make things so that it's equal between the husband and the wife and get rid of this oppressive institution. The second thing that will jump out at you about this is that as you read this, you will see that this has been the ideological blueprint, if you like, for much of what is called modern feminism and for much of what is called, what should be called, cultural Marxism. There is a whole thrust in our society. The whole of the sexual revolution really can be brought down to a kind of cultural Marxism, where they believe that the inequalities inside the home are evidence of injustice. Inequality between men and women is evidence of some kind of cosmic injustice that we are required to do something about. Okay, and so rather than viewing the family as an integrated social institution where you've got differences that are complementary, they view the differences as obvious evidence of oppression of some kind. And so you will see that what they seem to want, although they're not too explicit about it, is some kind of group marriage, which is to say no monogamy. You know, they don't want monogamy, and they want the children to be taken care of by the collective. Okay, and if children are taken care of by the collective, they tried to do that in Israel in the kibbutzim, and nobody could stand it. And they basically quit it because nobody could stand it. The kids didn't like it. The mothers hated it. You know, they just couldn't pull it off. Even the most dedicated, intelligent, possible people to try to implement this vision just couldn't do it. They couldn't stand it. The body objected to the whole thing. Okay, so but what you will see is how much of the modern sexual revolution really is corresponding to this. And what's interesting about this is that most of us here at Acton, would understand Marxism as an economic system to be a failed system. That's the point. We don't usually have to argue about at Acton University. People come here because they already are convinced about that point, right? But it's interesting to note, what I want to just point out to you, is that the Marxists haven't gone away. They are not convinced by all of the collapses, the economic calamities that they've created. They're not convinced by that. They have simply shifted their efforts into another field of endeavor, namely the family. Okay, so they haven't been able to achieve their goal of abolishing private property, so we just move over into another whole field of operation, which is to end the monogamous marriage and the monogamous family. And I wish I was exaggerating, but I'm not. So, you know, you can go read this for yourself if you're not sure. Okay, the government has played a role in disaggregating the family into a collection of individuals. This is what I want to point out to you. That's why I started by telling you about what a social institution is, so that you could see that a collection of individuals is not really the same thing as a social institution. And there are many ways in which the government in the United States, now I'm not talking about Cuba or something, I'm talking about in the United States, there are many ways in which the government is, in a sense, making war on the family as an institution, on marriage as an institution, to break it down into nothing but a collection of individuals. And one of the most dramatic cases I can think of is this case where the Supreme Court played a significant role in a case called Eisenstadt v. Baird. A lot of people have heard of Roe v. Wade in 1973. Some people have heard of Griswold versus Connecticut, which was in 1965. For those of you who are not from the U.S., Roe versus Wade was the Supreme Court decision that legalized abortion in all 50 states throughout pregnancy. 1965, Griswold versus Connecticut is the contraception case in which the Supreme Court found, listen to this, they found a right to use contraception inside marriage. And the grounds that they found was it was a right to marital privacy. Okay, in Griswold, most people don't know this, but in Griswold versus Connecticut in 1965, they held that the Connecticut anti-birth control statute, whatever it was, I don't even remember right now what it was, but the Connecticut statute was invalid because it was an undue interference by the government in the private decisions inside the marital bedroom. And so for that reason, the state could not regulate birth control. That was their argument. But in 1972, Eisenstadt versus Baird, the court says, wait a second, the marital couple is simply a collection of individuals. And as long as a marital couple has the right to do this, then each individual inside the couple has the right to do it. And so they are explicitly taking the couple apart, right, and turning it into just a collection of individuals, as you can see from this quotation. Whatever the rights of the individual to access contraceptives may be, the rights must be the same for the married and the unmarried alike. It's no surprise, then, it shouldn't surprise us, that a mere 1 year later, they found a right to unlimited abortion, okay, because now you've got free access to contraception as an individual right, okay, which means that there are people having sex outside of marriage, in situations that cannot sustain a pregnancy, that cannot possibly sustain a pregnancy, and so then you think, well, gosh, I'm pregnant, I need an abortion. So it's not, in a sense, too surprising, but that's not the main theme of my talk, so I don't want to linger on that. The main point is that what the court did, what the government did, an agency of the government, broke the marital couple down into a collection of individuals. Now, I want to also point out on this topic and on many others that when you're talking about the institution of marriage or the family, you're talking about the institution that connects the generations to one another. Okay? Are we all on board with that? I mean, that's what marriage does. This is where the generations unfold. And so if you change the basic ways in which men and women come together, the basic structure of the marriage institution in some way, you will not see the full impact of that change until at least a generation has gone by. Okay? And so that's true if you're looking at no-fault divorce, for example. It's very true. In 1969, people can say, oh gosh, we've had no-fault divorce for a year, nothing so terrible has happened, let's do it some more. You know, that kind of thing. Now we know it's been a mess, okay? The slide I want to show you here is that in Roe versus Wade, when people put forth Roe versus Wade in 1973, of course, this kind of slipped by everybody, but people were not ready for the Supreme Court to do what they did. But very few people, even people who favored it, did not expect the kind of outcome that has flowed from a full generation of the unlimited abortion license. So who would have predicted the post-birth abortion situation that I talked to you about earlier this morning, where a couple of medical ethics people simply pointed out that any situation where it's okay to do an abortion before birth, it should be equally okay to do the abortion after the baby's born. Normal people would call that infanticide or possibly murder, but these medical ethics guys are calling it post-birth abortion. Basically, letting the logic play itself out, the logic meaning that once you accept that the child in the womb is not a child and has no rights, there's no non-arbitrary way to stop the consequences of that. And so now we're there, okay? Sex selection abortion. Nobody in 1973 would have predicted the vast scale on which boys would be selectively chosen for birth, and which girls would be selectively chosen for abortion worldwide. Worldwide, sex selection abortion is a major problem. And worldwide, it has been calculated by responsible demographers that there is an excess of men over women caused by sex selection abortion to the tune of 163 million missing women and girls. Think about it, 163 million missing women and girls due to sex selection abortion. That's the equivalent of pretty much the entire female population of the United States. Okay, so think about that. That's what we're dealing with. Who would have predicted that in 1973? And then I came across this article by a fellow called Glenn Cohen, who's a Harvard law professor, talking about the regulation of reproduction, the problem with the best interest standards. And he makes this argument that I'll just read it to you. He's talking about situations where should the state be involved in regulating artificial reproductive technology, or should the state be involved in regulating reproduction in any way? Okay, that's what he's talking about. Now, think back to my first slide with those nice people there. They don't need any regulation. They're just doing it, right? I mean, these questions are only coming about because we're doing something that's outside the natural order in the first instance. But in any case, people are, you know, making objections to some of the harms that are coming about to children from being conceived artificially and so on and so forth. There are a number of things coming to light. And so this is what the Harvard Law professor has to say. Unless the state's failure to intervene would foist upon the child a life not worth living. In other words, it's got to be really bad. Any attempt to alter whether, when, or with whom an individual reproduces cannot be justified on the basis that harm will come to the resulting child, since but for that intervention, the child would not exist. So the point is, we're letting you get born, suck it up. You know, that's basically what we're saying. So do we owe kids anything beyond mere survival? These are some little children in a Romanian orphanage enjoying their communist upbringing. Now, what does it mean to say that the family is the most basic unit of society? Let's talk about that for a minute. What do we mean about that? By that, in the natural order and then in the supernatural order. The natural meaning of this statement, I think, is to say that the mother and father are the most basic unit of social cooperation. Now, in my previous lecture, I talked with you a bit about how the maternal bonding really socializes a child. And so the family being a basic unit of the most basic unit of society, that's an important element of what I'm talking about. But I don't want to review all of that I talked about in the first lecture earlier this morning. I just want to point out to you that if you think about people coming together to cooperate to get stuff done, mom and dad cooperating with their baby over the subject of their baby is just about as basic as it gets. Okay? So a lot of times, libertarians love the market because they go, quite correctly, the market is a unit of social cooperation. The market's a tool for people who are strangers and who don't like each other and who don't know each other. They can get together and they can do stuff. They can make pencils and books and, you know, all kinds of stuff. And they might even hate each other, but they're actually getting something done. And isn't that marvelous that it's this great thing of social cooperation? Have any of you ever heard that or any form of that? Am I making this up? Yeah, okay. Now, some of you, if you're first-timers at Acton, that might be a little much for you. But, yeah, you'll hear that kind of stuff in free market circles, right? I just want to point out, right, that mom and dad are a much more basic unit of social cooperation than the market. And so if you're a libertarian and you like the market because it's social cooperation, you should really love this, right? You should really love mom and dad working together. Now, the second, we've already pointed out that both mom and dad have rights and responsibilities with respect to their child. And the further natural meaning of marriage being a basic unit of cooperation or being the most basic unit of society, come on in, Father, there's a couple seats up here, is that I would put it to you this way, that the most essential public purpose of marriage is to attach mothers and fathers to their children and to one another. That's what marriage does. It attaches mothers and fathers to their children and to one another. And that's a pretty basic social function, right? It's creating and sustaining that ordinary unit that we talked about. And it also is the case that marriage, if you conceive of marriage in this way, is protecting the legitimate interests of children. And I want to pause on this for just a minute because people get hung up about this a lot of times. I would say to you that children have a legitimate interest in the stability of their parents' union. Okay? That is to say, children have a right to know who they are. They have a right to have a relationship with their parents. Okay? And if they don't have it, it's because something bad happened. It's not because somebody just felt like it, right? You need to have a reason. If you're going to deprive kids of a relationship with their parents, care from their parents, you need to have a reason, right? You just don't do that willy-nilly. So if it's true that kids have an interest in a relationship with their parents, then it must be true that they have an interest in the stability of their parents' union. Because without their parents' union, it's going to be hard for them to have a relationship with both parents. Not impossible. I'll give you not impossible. But you can see that kids have a legitimate interest. It's not an unbounded, unlimited interest or absolute interest, but it's a legitimate interest. By attaching children to their mothers and fathers and to each other, marriage is a proactive way of meeting that entitlement of children. Because children cannot march into court and say, see here, I haven't seen my father in 6 years, someone get over here and do something about it. You know, by the time the court gets around to doing something about it, another year has passed in that child's life, and another part of their developmental stage has gone by, and their interests have been harmed, really quite seriously damaged. So marriage proactively protects the interests of the child. And so that's what I think it means to say in the natural order, that the family is the most basic unit of society, the foundation, the building block of society. Now, in the supernatural meaning, I want to just pause on this a minute. We can talk about this in questions if you want to. Is that we believe as Christians, and this is something where I think this is mere Christianity. I don't think there's any dispute amongst the different denominations about this, is that God loved the whole world into existence. God created the world out of nothing as an act of pure love. That's what we believe. Isn't that what we believe? There's no argument about that? Okay. So we believe in a certain way God intends for us to love the next generation into existence, right? That the next generation comes into existence because man and woman have loved one another, just as God has loved creation into existence, okay? And so male and female are created by God, both male and female are created by God in His image and likeness. I learned yesterday from the Orthodox priest that image and likeness are two different things, and I had never thought about that before, so you should go listen to Father Jensen's lecture about that. It's really cool. And I would say to you that male and female are two different but complementary ways of being human. So unlike the Marxists who see the differences between men and women as some kind of evidence of something wrong, as some kind of cosmic injustice that we have to do something about, I would say that male and female are evidence of a complementary reality that are created by God for us to learn how to love. And if we lose the ability to be male and female, we're going to lose some of our humanity. And I fear that that's part of what's happening to us. So I want to now go, with that in mind, I want to go into this question of whether the state has in fact been neutral with respect to the family. Now this is an important question if you have libertarian friends. Because a lot of times your libertarian friends are going to say to you, the state, the government should just get away from the family, should just leave it alone and keep out of it and maybe let the church handle it or something like that. And people will figure it out on their own and it'll all be good. Okay, so have you ever heard arguments along those lines? I mean, I might be overstating it a little bit, but there's some variations in it, but that's pretty much what you hear, right? So what I want to say to you is that in all of these areas about the family, about human sexuality, about marriage, in my opinion, the concept of choice has basically been a Trojan horse. And you bring the horse into the city thinking, oh, we all get to choose what we want. But when you open the horse, all these little soldiers come running out. And it turns out that behind the smokescreen of choice is in fact a whole alternative moral vision of what human sexuality is about, of what marriage should be, of what kind of relationships you should choose or not choose. There is behind the rhetoric of choice a whole alternative morality that I believe could not withstand careful scrutiny. That's why nobody brings it out and talks about it directly. Right, because it would look stupid, right? So you hide behind this idea of autonomy and choice. And the reason I think that is that the government can and does implement a whole variety of policies that affect people's decision-making in this area, whether it be in their sexual behavior, their decision to marry or not marry, their decision to have kids, so on and so forth. The government has a lot of policy instruments that it uses and that it has been aggressively using. To do what? To smash the family into a collection of individuals. To take the social institution of the family, the natural institution, and smash it into nothing but a collection of atoms. So I'm going to give you a few examples. I don't know if I'll get to every single thing on my list here, but you can look at them and you can look at my references and, you know, maybe fill in the blanks yourself if we don't get to everything on the list. So let's think about some of the things just as a general matter. There are many government policies that impact the kind of decisions people make about what kind of relationship to be in. What kind of health care rules can have things built into them so that you can get health care. We talked this morning, somebody brought up this morning, the fact that a teenage girl can get an abortion and contraception without her parents knowing it. Now, is that a neutral policy with respect to the family? Quite obviously, it is not. It is something that actively undermines the authority of the parents, and that's part of federal law. That's in the Medicaid rules. Okay, I have it on a later slide, but since it came up right away, we'll talk about it. The tax policy, welfare policy, housing allowances. Who do you give housing allowances to? Whose housing do you subsidize? Who counts as a family for those kinds of purposes? Do you insist that the 16-year-old stay moved in with her mom and dad, or do you give a 16-year-old her own apartment if she's got a baby? Well, in the UK, they basically would give the 16-year-old her own apartment if she had a baby. So is that neutral? Okay, this is quite obviously not neutral. This is the state encouraging certain types of behavior. Now, I've listed these out here. I'm going to say a couple of things. The HHS mandate, OctoMom, so on and so forth on this one slide. They're on your lecture notes there. So let me just talk about a few of these in particular. I want to talk to you a little bit about the HHS mandate. For those of you who are not from the U.S., I don't know if you've heard about this, but the Health and Human Services Department is one of the large departments of the United States federal government, and we have a new health care law, which is commonly called Obamacare, and one of the executive decisions that has been made about Obamacare through the Department of Health and Human Services is that, first of all, everybody has to buy insurance. You have to buy insurance, so there's a kind of mandate to buy insurance in the first place. But that every employer, with an insignificant number of exceptions, every employer is required to provide certain services within the health insurance that they provide. And among those required services are contraception, abortion-inducing drugs, and sterilization services. Now, if you're from the United States, you should know that the Catholic Church has been very united in its opposition to this. If you're not from the U.S., you might be interested to know this is the first time that I can remember that every bishop in the United States in charge of a diocese has come on board with the same message saying this is wrong and we're not going to put up with it. We're not going to conform to this. Okay, now why are they so upset? And why should a libertarian care, by the way? Let's think about this. Libertarians, don't they always say, let's get the government out of private charity. Let's let the church take care of charity, right? Do they ever say? Have you ever heard that? Of course you hear that. Well, what is the largest non-governmental provider of social services in the world? That would be the American Catholic Church, okay? The HHS mandate is a not-so-subtle attempt to put the Catholic Church out of those businesses. The entire Catholic social service infrastructure is at stake here, is in play here. Okay, so implied in this is the government saying the government's paying for the health care, and so therefore they get to decide what counts as health care. And what have they decided? That pregnancy counts as an illness, that pregnancy begins at implantation, not at conception. They've decided that conception is some kind of disease that has to be prevented, okay? They don't see pregnancy as a natural, human, ordinarily functioning thing, right? And so they're treating this as preventive services. So plainly, the government is not being neutral. Any facade that this was about people choosing what they want, the cover is completely blown here, right? That simply can't be true. That this is about people's choice. If it was about choice, nobody would have ever thought of such a thing as this. Okay. Now I want to talk to you about OctoMom. I like to talk about OctoMom. If you've been at other talks of mine, I sometimes talk about OctoMom. There she is with all her babies, and I think one of her older children. It turns out, If we think that the government is completely neutral with respect to people's decision making, let's look at how the government influenced octomom's decision-making. Now, for those of you who are not from the U.S., octomom is this woman who gave birth to octoplets. And it was quite, it was considered kind of scandalous in the U.S. because she was on public assistance. She was on multiple forms of public assistance. And so she wasn't paying for her own health care, and she was not married. So she was using a sperm donor. She was using, and think about what a sperm donor means. It means that the government had created a legal institution for her that allows her to be impregnated without ever having a face-to-face contact with a person, right? The government's allowing her and making it possible for her to do this. Something is completely impossible in the natural order. Right? In the natural order, you have to have at least one encounter, right? Okay. So the government is making this possible for her to have a non-relationship and this providing her with all these services. And so she made a rational decision that it's a good idea for her to be a single mother of 8 children at a time, even though she already had 6 other children similarly conceived. So what you can tell your libertarian friends is that we'll get the government out of the marriage business once you get the government out of welfare, healthcare, housing, and legal institutions that are influencing people's decisions. Okay? The government's not neutral here. That's a point. The government's plainly not being neutral here. Okay. The federal government, here's another example of federal government's role, and this has to do with, the provision of contraception and contraception education through Medicare. In 1970, it's called Title X of the Public Health Services Act. This is the first time that the federal government created a policy of trying to control the fertility of American women, of trying to reduce fertility. Now, if you think about it a minute, go back and think about that Eisenstadt decision that we had up there a few minutes ago, where we have the Supreme Court telling us that it's absolutely somebody's private responsibility and decision-making to decide whether they're going to have a child or not. And now along comes the government creating a policy to say, we want you to have fewer kids. Well, if the Eisenstadt decision is true, what the heck business does the government have being concerned in the slightest about whether Mr. and Mrs. Morse have 2 children or 10 children or no children? It's none of their business. It should be none of their business. They made it their business. Part of the reason they made it their business, and you can see this in some of the documents surrounding the thing, is that the government had recently begun expanding its welfare provision to what? To unmarried mothers. For the first time, it wasn't just widows and orphans. It's now for unmarried mothers. And by golly, you've got, for those of you who know economics and you know the term moral hazard, have you heard moral hazard? You insure something, you get more of the thing you're insuring against. They, all of a sudden, gosh, they were having more single mothers and more kids being born out of wedlock. And so now the state decides we have the right to do something to control people's fertility because it's going to be a burden on us. Well, why is it a burden on you? Because you took on the burden. Right? You created the burden and then used that as a reason to intervene in people's lives. Now, there are a number of things, I don't have time to go into them all, but there are a number of ways in which Medicaid it has its thumb on the scale, let us just say, okay? And so I've just put a few of these on here. That birth control programs are a mandatory part of state Medicaid programs. There's no opt-out. And contraception is reimbursed at a more favorable rate than any other service under Medicaid rules, and birth control is given to minors over puberty with no state opt-out and with no parental notification. So again, these are not neutral policies, okay? This is not a morally neutral position. This is the government imposing something on the society that the society really, didn't particularly want or ask for. In fact, if you took a vote on it, probably a lot of people would say, no, this is probably a bad idea. When you think of Medicaid, you think about this big, broad thing, right, to try to help subsidize health care for poor people. But just like we're seeing with the HHS mandate and Obamacare, buried within those big old programs are a lot of detailed policies that, in fact, are influencing people's decisions. So the government is not being neutral with respect to any of this stuff. And what we're doing is, again, disaggregating the family into a collection of individuals. So now, not only are we saying husband and wife are just individuals, but we're saying the child is an individual, that the child needs to be protected from its parents, that the government is taking on the role of protecting the members of the family from one another, and no one is taking on the role of protecting the family as a unit from the state. The only people that are taking on that role are the people of the church who are speaking out against it. And so I wanted to give you this analysis because I thought it might be helpful to you as you go into these arguments to have just a little bit more to say. Rather, I know you all probably have these kind of intuitions, but we need to have a little bit more detail and something to say about this. And so what this government, in effect, has done has created a sexual culture that has to do with use and be used rather than love and be loved. That's what we've really created. And that's not something, you oftentimes hear, you guys are a bunch of dinosaurs, you're behind the times, march of history, rah, 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 this goose-stepping march of history. Right? We're all supposed to fall into line. This overlooks the fact that particular people have promoted particular policies for particular purposes. There was nothing inevitable about any of that. Somebody made some decisions. And that means we can make different decisions, right? It means there's nothing inevitable about the march of history. I mean, it's like history is some kind of god or something, right? History is some kind of, pantheistic thing. I don't know. But anyway, that's a Marxist holdover as well, by the way. The inevitable march of history, that's all Marxist rhetoric and so on. So what I want to say to you is that the government has not been neutral with respect to the marriage, with respect to family. The government is very much involved in defining what counts as a proper context for sexual behavior and a proper context for child rearing. The government's been very involved in that. And I would say to you that it's not truly possible to be completely neutral, that this goal of being neutral is something that has been thrown up to us as kind of a distraction. But in truth, we have to decide what kind of society we really want. Somebody has to decide. Somebody's been deciding. Somebody made these decisions. Kathleen Sebelius made some decisions, right? Somebody has to decide what kind of family environment that we believe is a good thing, good for human flourishing, good for men, women, and children, and then we have to take some steps to support that. To sit on the sidelines and not decide is, in fact, a decision. Right, you see what I mean? Not deciding to do nothing is, in fact, a decision. So, in light of what we heard last night from Arthur Brooks said to us that we have to reach for the heartstrings ourselves. We cannot just be talking about numbers and facts and figures. We have to have an alternative proposal. And I would say to you that the Christian proposal is very attractive. We believe that God loved the world into existence. I'm not ashamed to believe that. I hope you're not ashamed to believe that. We can, in fact, build a sexual culture and a family culture around that idea of love. Love and be loved rather than use and be used. And so I used to be a big proponent of, let's just use public arguments, let's keep theology out of it. And up to a point, that's right. And most of my talk, I've done that. But I think we need to say that the Christian proposal, the ancient teaching of the Christian church, what every denomination believed up right up until the day before yesterday, right, is that the proper context for both sex and child rearing is inside marriage, and that God loved the world into existence, and that He wants us to participate in that. That's what we think the cosmos is about, that at the center of the cosmos is a deep, abiding love that we want to be part of. We want you to be part of it, too. And I think that can add up to a very appealing proposal. Thanks very much. Let's do questions.
You've just been listening to Dr. J's talk on The Family and the State from Acton University 2012. For her other talks, Economics 101 and The Family and the Market, check out the previous podcasts. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.